darkness falls, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. My God will never fail. Oh, my God will never fail. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory.
Well, good evening, and thank you so much for joining us tonight for Grace Church Online. It is so very, very good to have you once again, and we are so very appreciative that you choose to spend an hour or so with us, and so we want to make the most of that time with you. So we're going to have a time of worship and also a great message from Pastor Jackie as she rounds off a thought that she's shared over the last couple of times that she's been sharing. So looking forward to bringing that to you. Also looking forward to, well, I'll give you a sneak peek, but it's not really ready at the moment, but our brand new website is going to be up and running within the week. In the next couple of days, go to gracegathering.online. If you've been there previously, you'll go there this time and it will look a little bit different. And I've just been spending some time updating that, and we're very excited that that is not too far away. Also not too far away is Father's Day. It's just a couple of weeks here in Australia, the 4th of September. We would love for you to join us in person during the morning of that Sunday at 9:30 a.m. at the Multi-Purpose Centre, which is 143 Dora Street in Morisset. And we're looking forward to celebrating the dads and hoping to do one or two very special things for them as well. So that's the 4th of September. Now, in October, something is happening, and we are super excited to be joining and jumping on board. It's the Mighty Gospel Tent. It's taking place at the Maitland Showground, October 19 through to 26. Evangelist Tim Hall is going to be sharing each and every night. I think it's the Friday night, will be directed towards youth and young adults and a bunch more. But to give you an idea, have a watch of this video.
Something really powerful is coming to the Hunter Valley. This is miraculous. This is courageous. This is life-changing. This is Pastor Tim Hall and his crusade team coming with all the folks from over the Hunter Valley for the Mighty Gospel Tent. 8 nights, 2,000 seats, powerful worship, victorious praise, and the great news of the life-changing gospel of Jesus. We'll be there to pray for the sick and to minister to people every night. And this is your opportunity to experience a fresh touch of heaven on your life. October 19 through 26, 7 p.m. every night, Maitland Showground. Bring your friends, your family, your neighbours, and we will see you there.
Yeah, the Mighty Gospel Tent, October 19 through to 26. Now, we'll let you know in the weeks to come how you can be involved, and that could be volunteering. It might actually be sewing in financially. As you can imagine, an event like this requires a lot of resource, financial and otherwise. The tent seats about 2,000 people. So very much at this stage, what we want to ask you to do is be praying for those that are involved in terms of leading this event, the local coordinators here in our region, in the Hunter region of New South Wales. Just be praying for them, praying that hearts would be softened, and those that are seeking Jesus or looking for answers to what's going on in the world, that they might find themselves inside the gospel tent during one of the night meetings. I think it's 7 o'clock each night they'll be on, and a few events during the day as well, particularly across the weekend. So asking you to pray for that, and also asking you to be prayerful for whatever God's got for you tonight, because we do believe very much that He wants to speak to you through tonight's service. So we're going to head into a time of worship. If you haven't done so already, just say hello in the chat function. We'd love to be able to just connect with you, albeit digitally and via our text on a computer screen or a tablet screen or a phone screen, but we still want to connect with you. So just say hello in the chat function as we head into worship. Pastor Jackie, not too far away.
Silence it. Cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet. My Savior on that cursed tree. Body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah still and all alone. Oh, blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints. My gaze transfixed on Jesus' face.
If you're in the room this morning, hopefully you've heard part one and part two of this series, Clear Oil for the Lamp. Now, I wasn't quite sure where we were going to be heading with it because there's so much. God has just showed me time and time again, more and more and more, till we're up to like 28 pages now. But I love that. As soon as I go to him, I don't have much time through the week with six kids and things that go on. But whenever I come to him, he's there, and he goes straight away. He shows me some truth and blesses me, and I'm just humble. I just am humble before him as he lavishes upon me his treasure. So this is going to be the final one, Clear Oil for the Lamp, part three. And it touches on some of the things that we've shared before. So if you haven't seen those messages and then you feel like you need to go back just to understand what's happening today, then you can go to gracegathering.online to find that. So I've been sharing, as I said, over the past couple of messages. It's not every week, but it's kind of sporadically when I get up here to preach. I've been sharing from the Old Testament book of 1 Samuel. And that's the story of Eli the priest, of Hannah and Samuel. And there we've been kind of drawing out lots of bits of treasure from God's word, but basically based around the theme of grace versus law. And I love that God's been showing us multiple themes, and we've been identifying how God has set apart or called out people throughout generations. People just like you and me that he's called out through generations, and he's been showing us his kingdom plans and purposes through the word of God from generation to generation. And we know that this also applies to us as the church. Okay? So it's not something for the past and we say, oh, that's just for them. It's actually for you, because God has set apart the church for such a time as this. So I want you to kind of hold on to that this morning. So as believers, we've been set apart, as I've been sharing, as the light of the world. And in the same way that God separated the light and the darkness at the beginning in creation, we too, okay, the church, are to be the light in the world. And Jesus tells us in Matthew 5, 14 to 16, "You are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven." Now, it's okay to talk about this light, but how do we shine this light? We hear about it quite often in the Bible. We think, light, okay, what does that actually mean? What do I have to do? What do we have to do? Am I meant to be working overtime, doing these good works from here to here and rushing and doing things like that so that people can see this light? It's kind of maybe a question that you've thought over the years. So how do we shine this light? Well, the answer to that question is no. No, we don't need to go rushing around from place to place, overworking and doing good works all the time. It is a blessing to others when we do good works, and I'm not encouraging you to stop, I'm encouraging you to keep going. But that's not how we shine the light necessarily. It's not the whole part of the truth. So doing good works out of an obligation to earn something is law. So we can't shine our light in the world by just doing good works, because the world can do good works. So what is this light then? So the answer is no. It's not just about running around everywhere doing good works. So under the old covenant of the law, you needed to strive continually to keep the law, to maintain your purity before God. So there's a whole list of things to do, and we know about the Ten Commandments, but there's actually so many more of those laws that they had to keep, and they had to strive continually, okay? And we had to maintain those laws perfectly, or we lost our purity or our holiness before God. But under the new covenant of grace, we are simply to trust in the finished work of Jesus. And out of that heart relationship with Jesus will flow a desire to do good deeds, to do good works. But we can't earn this light and shine it around, because the world can do that. The world can do good deeds. This light is a different light. So Jesus tells us in John 8, verse 12, "When Jesus spoke again to the people, he said, 'I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life.'" So as believers, we know that when we accept Jesus as our Savior, the Spirit of God comes and lives inside of us. Okay, at that very point of salvation, when we ask Jesus into our heart, okay, we receive the Spirit of God. He comes and lives inside of us. So Romans 8, verse 11. "The Spirit of God who raised Jesus from the dead lives in you. And just as God raised Christ Jesus from the dead, he will give life to your mortal bodies by this same Spirit living within you." So at that very point when we ask Jesus into our heart, the Spirit of God comes and lives inside of us. So when that happens, when the Spirit of God comes and lives inside of us, Jesus, the light of the world, comes and lives inside of us. So it's not something out there that we're working towards earning. At the point of salvation, the Spirit of God comes, as we just read, and lives inside of us. And that means Jesus, the light of the world, comes and lives inside of us. So church, as individual believers, you are the carriers of the light. We don't have to go out there earning it through good deeds. We actually carry the light. The light of the world lives in us, and we carry that light. We are carriers of the Spirit of God, carriers of His presence wherever you go. So if you walk over here, the light is here. If you work over there, the light is there. When you live in a particular place in your street, the light is there. We don't have to go outside looking. How do I work this light? How do I do good deeds to find this light and shine it? You actually carry His light. So I love that picture, because if you think about yourself as a light walking into places, doesn't matter if it's a supermarket, the petrol station, wherever. Think about you as that light and what happens when you walk into a place and the light illuminates that place. Jesus, the light of the world, is in us. You are carriers of His presence, of His light. And wherever you are, His light shines. In your street, you don't know how many Christians are up and down your street. Just picture your street in your mind right now and picture a light here, a light here, a light here, a light here. It's not about what you can do. It's about that you already carry the presence of God. You are carriers of a light, and your light will shine. Doing good deeds is wonderful. God wants us to be a blessing to others. He calls us to be a blessing to others, but we don't earn that light. We carry His light through His Spirit. Now we're going to have a look at this picture, and it just kind of, God showed me this. This is a picture of Australia from space with the lights. But I think it's a good illustration. These are natural lights, but it's a good illustration for us to think supernaturally. If you looked at all of the Christians and all of the churches across Australia, there are the lights. You're one of those, shining, separating the darkness. And I think when God showed me this, and I also saw the world from space and all the lights across the world. Now, if you look at that, the rest of the place is dark. And it puts it in contrast to that of what will happen when the rapture comes. And if we think of this being the church or the believers all across Australia, and when the light is taken out of this world, that map of Australia will be black. The light will be gone. Church, you are the light of the world. You carry the light, His presence, wherever you go. Sometimes we're not even aware of it. You think, oh, this person connected with me. What are they, you know, what are they talking to me about? You're kind of not quite sure, but they're attracted to the light. They're attracted to His presence living in you. The Spirit of God lives in you. So what is the light of life? So previously in the scripture we read, whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. So what is the light of life? From the beginning, God wanted the light to separate the darkness. It's the very first thing that is spoken into creation. Let there be light. Let it separate it from the darkness. If we have Jesus, then we have the light of life. And we're to go about as believers sharing about Jesus. It may be in a spoken way. It may be in the way that we live our lives. I know for me, my family, after 20 plus years, are starting to see the light of life. There's something different about you. It's taken 20 plus years of me living and praying for them and talking to them, but they're starting to see the light of life. And they're questioning their life. Life is the opposite of death. From the beginning of creation in the Garden of Eden, God wanted humankind to choose life. Genesis 2, verse 8 to 9. Now the Lord God had planted a garden in the east, in Eden, and there he put the man he had formed. The Lord God made all kinds of trees grow out of the ground, trees that were pleasing to the eye and good for food. In the middle of the garden were the tree of life and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. From the beginning, God wanted humankind to choose life. He set before them life and death, and he wanted them to choose life. Genesis 2, 16 to 17. And the Lord God commanded the man, "You are free to eat from any tree in the garden, but you must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, for when you eat from it, you will certainly die." We know the story. We know as it continues that Adam and Eve chose death by consuming the lies. First, they consumed the lies of the enemy. That's the first thing they ate, so to speak. They consumed the lies of the enemy, and then they ate from the wrong tree. They were to eat from the tree of life. And as we know, sin entered the world, and death, the opposite of life, became part of God's creation. Everything that God spoke into existence was good and full of life. If you read through the book of Genesis, and it was good, and it was good, and it was good, and it was full of life and activity. But Adam and Eve's choice brought death, the opposite of life. So God's plan all along was for life. It has never been for death. So in the Old Testament book of Deuteronomy, we read that even under the old covenant, God's plan was for humankind to choose life. Deuteronomy 30, verse 19. "I call heaven and earth to witness against you today that I have set before you life and death, blessing and curse. Therefore, choose life that you and your offspring may live." So from the very beginning, there was a choice, life or death. And as we go through the Old Covenant, through the Old Testament, time and time again through the books we read, choose life, choose life, choose life, choose life. And God is continuing to tell us today to choose life. He doesn't want anybody to perish. And then again, many generations later, Jesus reminds us about what happened in the past in the Garden of Eden, where Adam and Eve chose death, and how that was never God's plan. Life was always God's plan. Jesus was always God's plan. John 10:10. "The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly." He's reminding us, if we think back to that story, they chose life because the thief came and stole that life in the garden. The thief only comes to steal, kill, and destroy. And that's what he did in the garden. And Jesus is reminding us, that's what the thief does. And he tries it on again today. But I'm here to tell you, Jesus has a victory. This morning as we were singing some of those songs, I was just stomping. You might have thought I looked a bit weird, John. It's okay. "But he's under my feet, the enemy. And I was stomping him during that time of singing victory because the enemy is under my feet. He can try and come and steal and kill and destroy, but Jesus came that they may have life. And I choose life. I choose Jesus, the light of life. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly." Jesus died on the cross so that we might have life. His sacrificial death purchased life for all of humankind once again, like it was meant to be from the garden. It was meant to be life from the beginning. And he came and he restored life. And today, God wants you to choose the light of life, his son, Jesus. Jesus, he says, whoever follows him will have the light of life. Romans 10, verse 9. Because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. And we know, I share it constantly with you, when we're saved, when we ask Jesus into our heart, we move from that eternal death and we move into eternal life. Life abundantly and life eternal. Choose life. For those of us who are already believers, this is the good news that we have to proclaim, that Jesus' death brought life. Life that can only be found in him and not in the things offered by the world. That's the good news. We come to tell them about the light of life. That's how we share the light. We tell them about the light of life. Whoever walks and follows him will never be in darkness. They will have the light of life. So we come and we share that with people and we say, here is the light of life. It's not offered in the world. It's offered only in Jesus. Jesus tells us in Luke 4, verse 18, the Spirit of the Lord is on me because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free. He has come to bring life. All of those other things are found in the world and they bring death. If you are oppressed, it brings death to your life. If you're in poverty, you can still be blessed and have a thankful heart. But if you're in poverty, it can bring a similar sort of thing like death. Jesus came to bring life abundant and to set those people free. So when we have the Spirit of God inside of us at salvation, we can also have, in that scripture, it tells us, the Spirit of the Lord is on me. It can be in me and on me. I can carry an anointing, and I'll share about that in a moment. So I want to head back today to Leviticus 24. We've been sharing a little bit about the menorah in the tabernacle. Okay, and it's a passage of scripture we've been looking at over the past few messages. And it outlines, in Leviticus, it outlines all those detailed, specific instructions of how the priests were to maintain the lamp, the menorah, in the tabernacle. Leviticus 24, verse 1 to 2. The Lord said to Moses, command the Israelites to bring you clear oil of pressed olives for the light, so that the lamps may be kept burning continually. And I've shared a little bit longer in the portion of scripture before where it's mentioned three times for the priest to continually maintain the light. Continue to maintain the separation of light and darkness. And he calls us to do that too, church. Continue to maintain that separation from light and darkness in the world. So in verse 2, you'll see there that I've done it in a special colour. In verse 2, we read that the Israelites are to bring the priests clear oil of pressed olives for the light. We're just going to look at that, the oil. The lamp would burn that clear olive oil and produce light in the darkness of the holy place. There's a whole message just on that one yellow writing. Oil is significant in the Bible. Olives are significant in the Bible. And that clear oil, when we look at the Hebrew in a moment, is significant in the Bible. Clear oil of pressed olives for the light. So in Hebrew, clear olive oil is zak, zait, shemen. And that's how it's written word for word in the Bible in that passage of scripture. In Hebrew, that zak means pure or clean, holy, set apart. And zait is the olive, and shemen is one of the words for oil. Now, last time I shared, we'd looked at a word similar with that shem in it. Shem means name, and we looked at Samuel's name, and his name was Shem El, the name of God. And we know that when God, in the Bible, names are important, and God links character to a person through their name. And so that word Shem Men, there's a whole lot that I can go into just on that, but I want you just to look at that Shem part, name. Linked to Shem El, Samuel, name of God. And we know that whenever God links his name to something, there's a distinction he's trying to show us. So to get this clear olive oil, the Israelites would press the olives in an olive press. And it was the very first pressing that produced the clear oil for the light. The very first time it was pressed produced that really clear olive oil. That's what they're talking about here in Zach Zayet Shemen. That very first pressing, it produced the clear oil, the pure oil, the clean oil. And then the olives could then go on to be pressed further multiple times to produce more oil. But it was a different quality of oil, second, third, fourth pressings. And they were used for other purposes like food, ointment, soap, a whole range of different things. But it's the clear oil we're talking about, the first pressing, that pure, clean oil. And this clear oil was set apart for the holy things of the temple. And it was also used for anointing. So that clear oil, that clean oil, had God's name attached to it because of the Shem. There's a whole range of things in just looking at the letters in that word that point us to Jesus. So the oil has something to do with God. It's holy, it's clean, it's set apart. And we know that olives represent something important in the Bible as well. It represents the people of God set apart. And Jesus was pressed. Think about what he went through. He was pressed from every side. From the time of Gethsemane, which is a garden of olives. Jesus was pressed on every side to produce clean, pure oil. This clean, pure oil is representation of Jesus. And we know that it was the oil in the lamp that was burnt to produce the light. Jesus is the light of the world. When we have that clean, pure, beautiful oil living inside of us, it is to burn and produce light. I love that Jesus started that journey at the Garden of Gethsemane. There's that word, semene, oil, olive. It means olive mill or olive press. He was pressed on every side, and that pure oil, his fragrance, his beauty, his light poured out of him. And we have that oil inside of us. The Spirit of God lives inside of us. And we can burn like that menorah lamp, not in our own strength, but by the Spirit of God. So we link God's name to that pure oil, that Shem. And when oil burns, it produces light, the light of life. In Moses' tabernacle, the menorah was an external light. It was shining in the darkness within that tabernacle in the holy place, and it was an external light. But now the light is an internal light. Jesus is our internal light, and we carry his presence wherever we go. So oil is also, as I said earlier, is also linked to anointing. The holy things were anointed with oil. There's lots of places through the Bible that were anointed with oil, rocks and altars and all kinds of things were anointed with oil to make them holy, or sacred or set apart as places of worship. So like we just read in Luke 4:18, the Spirit of the Lord is on me because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. So when we ask Jesus into our heart, we receive the Spirit of God. The Spirit of God is in us, but he can also come on us. As it says there, the Spirit of the Lord is on me. It's an anointing that comes on us so that we can shine even brighter. Jesus left the Holy Spirit here with us so that the light would never go out. Like the priests had to continually maintain that menorah, Jesus left the Holy Spirit so that the light of the world would never go out. And we need the anointing of the Holy Spirit flowing in our midst so that the light separates the darkness. Now, for some of us, I know not necessarily everyone in the room, but maybe people watching online, there's a fear sometimes of the Holy Spirit. I think, oh, I'm not quite sure about that. Well, the Holy Spirit is a beautiful gift from our Heavenly Father. I know that God is good. And if I know that God is good, then every gift that he's going to give me is good. And the Holy Spirit is this amazing gift that he gives us. And it can manifest in different ways with speaking in tongues and an anointing for healing and all kinds of gifts. And words of encouragement. It's not something to be scared of. He's not something to be scared of. He is a person, the Holy Spirit. And he lives inside of you already. If you have asked Jesus into your heart, he is already there. But there's also an anointing that can come upon us for different purposes. We need the anointing of the Holy Spirit. And it's our heart relationship with Jesus that reveals the light to others. We don't go out earning good deeds and I make my light shine over here. It comes out of a heart response that Jesus loves me so much. I'm overwhelmed by his beauty and his majesty and his graciousness in my life that I want to share that with others. This week I was reading some scriptures and I just started weeping. I was just weeping at his goodness and that I have the opportunity to share with you. But there are people out there who still need to hear the goodness of God. So my heart is that you would be that shining light in your street. That you would be that shining light as you go to the supermarket, at work, on your travels, on your walk, your bike rides, whatever. That you would be the light of the world, that you would carry his presence. It's not continually striving. You're just carrying his presence. Know who you are, church. You are children of God and he delights in you. He delights in you. 2 Corinthians 4 verse 6. For God who said, let there be light in the darkness, has made this light shine in our hearts so we could know the glory of God that is seen in the face of Jesus Christ. God led me to this scripture. I don't think I even really know it. But it's exactly what he's been laying on my heart. Let there be light in the darkness. That's what he said in creation. He's made this light shine in our hearts. And it's in the face of Jesus Christ. We are carriers of the light of the world. Our lives are transformed when we behold the beauty of Jesus. That's how the light shines. When we are so infatuated with him, when we behold him in all his glory and his majesty and his beauty, we are transformed. when we stand in his presence and we declare him worthy. When we seek his face and we open our hearts and we ask him to come in. And out of that flows the light.
Yeah, thank you so much, Pastor Jackie, for sharing your heart. And I know very much that our desire for her and for me and for us as a church is for us to be that light of the world so that people can actually see the difference that Jesus is making in our lives. And you might not be aware of this, but a long, long time ago, Pastor Jackie, she's my wife, but she was in America and we had some friends over there who were Christians that led her to salvation in Jesus. And she came back to Australia, because I was in Australia working, and she came back and she shared about Jesus, and I just sort of said, look, I'm not really interested. That's great for you. I'm happy for you, but I'm not very interested. But over the next couple of years, what I actually saw was I saw my wife transform. I saw the impact that Jesus had made in her life. And she very much, as she shared tonight, she very much was shining his light through how she was living and how she was speaking. And ultimately, that was probably the biggest thing that led me to salvation in Jesus. And now, a couple of decades later, pastoring Grace Church and doing all kind of ministry opportunities and the walking through doors that he has opened for us. So never underestimate the value and the importance of just walking with Jesus, staying close to him and making sure that you are shining your light. Hey, don't forget you can join us Sunday mornings, 9:30 a.m. in person. Nothing quite like gathering together in person in the room. And that is at the Multipurpose Center in Morisset. And you can also stay connected during the week by heading to our website, gracegathering.online, soon to be brand new website, hopefully the next few days. But at any time you can head there and stay connected with what God is doing through his church. Well, thank you so much for your company on a Tuesday evening. We pray that you have a blessed rest of tonight. We pray that your week is absolutely fantastic and it's over and above anything that you could dream or imagine. And we look forward to catching up with you next time.